Welcome to Coding the Future. We're here at CES 2025. With me today is Mike Lenné, Chief Science and Innovation Officer at Seeing Machines. Mike, thanks for stopping by.
G'day, Matt.
Now, we wanted to have you in Seeing Machines here because what you guys are doing is really impactful. You guys are one of the foremost leaders of the driver monitoring software space. You're tackling one of the industry's most pernicious problems, which is accidents, motor-related vehicle deaths, that kind of thing. I mean, this is a global issue. And even in the US alone, I read recently that there's 1,700 motor vehicle deaths every 2 weeks, which is the equivalent of two Boeing 747s crashing midair and killing everyone on board. Now, if this were the FAA and that were happening, all planes would be grounded. So I think what you guys are doing is really impactful. And maybe we can start there. If you can talk a little bit about your mission, your value prop, and what you bring to help tackle some of those issues.
Yeah. Look, it's a great intro. This is a global problem, right? Road trauma is something that we have, as a society, become, I think, too complacent with. We accept an extraordinary amount of death and injury on our roads. And I guess at Seeing Machines, where our mission is to get everyone home safely. It's as simple as that. Across any mode of transport, cars, trucks, buses, planes. And that has been our vision for 25 years now, since we were founded. And it really does drive everything we do. And so driver monitoring, interior sensing, it offers the industry, for the first time, an opportunity to really tackle these problems.
Right.
In a really new way. If I want to know if you're distracted or drowsy right now, the best way for me to do it is to look at you.
Right. Am I dozing off?
And I look to see, are you holding a phone?
Yeah.
Are you looking at a phone?
Yeah.
Are you head nodding? Are you collapsing? Uh-huh. And so that's essentially what our technology does, right? It enables that insight about human behavior. And that fundamentally sort of underpins our approach to this value proposition about getting everyone home safely.
So what is the threshold then to determine whether or not someone is distracted or tired or whatnot? And, you know, I guess, how do you prevent false flags? And then what are the downstream ramifications of being alerted? Like, are there any tie-ins to usage-based insurance? If I'm a truck driver, is that the kind of stuff that's going to go up to my boss? You know, am I going to get dock points? Talk a little bit about the downstream effects.
Okay, there's a couple of things in there. But so in terms of the fatigue and distraction thresholds, so effectively they're tied to the risk in any given situation.
Okay.
So for example, for distraction, if you're driving on a residential street at 20 miles per hour, that's a very different environment than driving on a free lane freeway.
Of course.
At 100 miles per hour.
Of course.
So what we do is we threshold the distraction alert timing to align with the risk with that situation.
Uh-huh, okay.
And that's a really important part of personalizing, right? And so what happens is that information is consumed differently through an OEM path and through an aftermarket path. So through an OEM path, that would drive any form of interaction with the driver. So it could just be an in-vehicle warning, you know, through a platform like QNX,
yeah,
cabin.
Yeah.
It could be visual, could be auditory. It could also go further and alter the threshold of other safety systems. So if you're distracted, maybe we should prime the forward collision warning system and the lane departure warning system.
That's a great point, yeah.
So there's a number of different strategies, and ultimately, if you're falling asleep, the highest level of intervention would be reducing speed, you know, performing a safe vehicle stop maneuver.
Yeah. Okay.
From the insurance point, look, absolutely, there are significant opportunities there. We've had some of our aftermarket heavy vehicle customers report to us that, you know, they've realized, you know, savings to the level of 50% in their insurance costs. You know, fatigue represents, in a fleet setting, along with distraction, mm-hmm. the primary safety risks.
Yeah.
And so this is a really unique solution to those risks. And so, you know, that's resonating with insurance companies now that companies have a way of identifying and then managing this risk.
Gotcha. So you mentioned, you know, the integration with QNX Cabin. We had our announcement with you guys earlier this week. I mean, that's exciting. I guess, how do you see that being received by the OEMs? You talked about, you know, usage-based insurance and whatnot, but what about the automakers themselves? Why do you think this is an attractive value prop to them?
Yeah, look, I think it's super exciting and attractive because fundamentally, I think it does two things. One, from a technology perspective, it de-risks for the OEM, right? Technology like ours is already integrated, right? There's a seamless integration into QNX Cabin. And so from an OEM purchasing viewpoint, that removes a lot of risk, right?
Yes.
So it simplifies.
Sure.
So that equals, you know, less development time, less risk.
That's what it's all about.
Yep.
Yeah.
And secondly, I think from a user experience and personalization viewpoint, there are some really unique value propositions here.
Yeah.
You know, the more we know about the context, what's happening in the cabin, what's happening outside the cabin, the more that we can understand behavior for both safety and convenience, and the more we can personalize. And I think that is really, you know, one of the massive trends, you know, at CES today, and I think at CES of next year is there's a lot of talk about human-centered AI and personalization, yes. But really look around the floor, who's really doing it? I think this sort of opportunity, this platform and partnership from an OEM perspective, it offers really, really interesting and valuable opportunities to enrich context, enrich user experience.
Yeah.
And ultimately, people will buy based on safety, but they'll also buy based on experience.
So, I mean, just pausing on that end user experience piece, if I'm shopping for a new car, is this the kind of thing that I'm told up front? I'm not surprised about this after the fact. And I guess what have you heard in terms of feedback? Are people, do they see this as an attractive aspect, or do some kind of balk or take a step back because they think about privacy implications and whatnot? Is there one predominant reaction, or what's your sense?
Look, but there's definitely positive feedback once people understand.
Yeah, it's about the education.
It's about the education. And really, this is not about Big Brother, right? There's no data streams that are shared. We don't need images. We don't need video.
Yeah.
We would love that to be regulated. That it's not required.
Yeah.
So really, what we're looking at here is, you know, providing a industry first mechanism to keep drivers
safe
themselves, them their family, safely. Their friends, get them home safely. Yeah. Exactly.
Who could argue with that, right?
Who could argue with that?
No, I read on your website recently that over the past 12 months, you guys have detected 18 million, distraction events and 300,000 fatigue, and you've made 300,000 fatigue interventions. I mean, that's a ton of data. I presume, you know, your team has sort of mined that. Are there any trends that you guys have, you know, have bubbled up to the surface in terms of, are there particular times of day, types of vehicles, types of individuals that are more, you know, more likely to, you know, be asleep at the wheel, if you will?
And
have you made any product tweaks based on those kinds of trends?
So that's a really timely question. We actually just released our first Guardian Insights report. So this the trends and the data that you refer to are from 62,000 vehicles, heavy vehicles around the world. And I think there are some specific trends around different regions, etc. I think one really important finding is most people think that the longer they drive, the greater the risk. But that's actually not the case. And what we find is that a lot of the time drivers are drowsy or tired is actually very early in the trip. It's not just very late in the trip.
It's quite contrarian. I wonder why that is.
So it could depend on the time of day that the trip is starting.
Yeah.
What someone has done in the preceding 6 hours.
They started driving and then they went to get the cup of coffee.
Exactly. Or they were out doing some other work for 6 hours.
Yeah.
And then they hop in a vehicle.
Right.
So I think that's been a fundamental insight, because from a regulatory viewpoint, there is this assumption that if you drive for 5 hours, you're safe, but if you drive for six, you're not.
Yes.
Whereas
there's lots of limitations on pilots and whatnot.
Exactly. Yeah. So now there's this mechanism to have an intelligent scheduling. This is really, I think, a really exciting development is let's just not schedule pilots or drivers based by a rule book.
Yeah.
Let's schedule and operate by actual risk.
Yeah.
And we can do that now.
That's fascinating. You mentioned the regulatory space. I want to spend a moment on that. Are there any regions where this is mandated? I mean, there's a long history of new technology innovations becoming, you know, absolutely critical, thinking back to safety or seatbelts and, you know, backup cameras and whatnot. What does that space look like for DMSs right now? And I guess, what does the outlook look for their adoption globally in mandating?
So it's a hive of activity. So effectively, Europe has led the way. So the European Commission has regulated technology for all vehicles sold in Europe for fatigue or drowsiness and distraction, effectively from the middle of next year.
Okay.
So
all new models.
Every single new vehicle. So that's seismic.
Yeah, of course.
And that has driven a very dramatic change in industry behavior. Mm-hmm. It's also matched by the European National Crash Assessment Protocol, or NCAP. So that's mm-hmm. the organization that issues 4-star or 5-star safety ratings to OEMs. So I actually sit on that panel that drives the standards for that. And that's really driving this technology into the European market.
Right.
In the US, we are also engaging directly with NHTSA, mm-hmm. National Highway Traffic Safety Administration here in the US. I think it's fair to say the regulatory process, progress is a little slower.
Yes, a bit of a different ballgame.
A different ball game. But look, we do have an MOU with NHTSA where we're exposing our technology to safety groups and regulators such as NHTSA.
Yeah.
So we really are trying to advance sensible discussion about how we can implement this life-saving technology.
Yeah, that's great. You mentioned some of the insights that came out of the data that you unearthed over the previous year. Is there a topic or an aspect of the industry, DMSs in general, that you think hasn't necessarily gotten the attention it should have this past year, and you how you expect that to change in the year ahead?
Yeah, look, I think really it's around acknowledgement of the safety potential.
Yeah.
We're talking about, in the United States, for example, over 10,000 people every year die on the US roads from intoxication or drowsiness or distraction. Multiply that by 10 for every person that's seriously injured.
Right, right.
So, we have a massive,
huge potential
trauma problem here. Yeah. And I'd love to see the industry excitement around the implementation of this safety technology
fully
match
it.
The need.
Yeah, yeah, for sure.
That is there on our roads today. In the United States, for example, this driver monitoring technology is used for hands-free mm-hmm. or assisted level 2 driving.
Yeah.
In the General Motors Cadillac, the Ford Blue Cruise, these vehicles have our technology to monitor driver attention so that the driver can take their hands off the wheel.
Yeah.
The sensor's there.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? It's there. Uh-huh. It's in over nearly 3 million cars.
Wow.
Let's also use it for distraction and drowsiness.
Yeah.
And then let's also use it for some of the other convenience and other features that could be enabled through the QNX cabin partnership.
Yeah, that's great. I mean, we're thrilled to be working with you. I think, it's an extremely valuable cause. I mean, who wouldn't be on board with it, right? So, I mean, you've been in the industry a long time. You think back many years ago, is there a particular piece of advice that you would give your younger self when you were starting out, knowing what you know now?
Look, when I started, I studied psychology. And I studied the effects of sleep loss and alcohol on driving.
Oh, interesting. Yeah.
And I wasn't sure as a young student what the pathway was.
Yeah.
Where it could take me, what impact it could have. Uh-huh. And now I'm sitting here leading technology innovation for, the market leader in this class of technology. So I just think don't doubt yourself, right? If you see an opportunity, pursue it. Don't place limits on what's possible. Because you never know where your passion and how that's going to align with industry trends. Who would have known 10 years ago even that this class of technology would be appearing? The estimates are by 2030, driver monitoring will be around 80% of all new cars globally. So 10 years ago, 15 years ago, no one could have imagined that.
Yeah.
So, I just think it's, I feel incredibly lucky. To have followed through on that path, and advice would be, don't place limits, be open to ideas.
Great advice. You got a great mission. Excited to see where it takes you. Thrilled to be working with you. So thanks again, Mike. Really appreciate you sitting down with us today.
Terrific, Matt. It was great. Thank you.